In 1972, the last year for which they have complete statistics, there were over 25,000 suicides in the United States, 200,000 suicide attempts, and 800,000 suicide threats. On the day before Christmas, when I was doing a news story on Statin Island, I heard a police radio message that there was a jumper on the Verrazzano Bridge. That's the bridge which runs between Statin Island and Brooklyn. It turned out that he was a businessman named Paul Sasso who had apparently decided to end it all because his business, a small construction company, was going under, and he hadn't been able to pay his employees since August. The only check he had given them had bounced. On the morning of Christmas Eve Day, his employees pressed him. They told him how they desperately needed their back pay to buy something for their own families for Christmas. Sasso told them that he could get the money from a loan shark in Manhattan. And he told his workers that he would drive from Statin Island into the city to pick up the cash. Understandably skeptical, two of his employees said that they would drive with him. While Sasso was driving the car, they entered the lower level of the bridge, but halfway across, Sasso stopped, said he'd be right back, and calmly walked out onto a steel girder hundreds of feet above the entrance to New York Harbor. That's where I found him. The Verrazzano Bridge is now the longest suspension bridge in the world, but the Golden Gate across San Francisco Bay is still far and away the most popular spot for death leaps. They've had about 500 so far. Well, Sasso told police officers who were trying to talk him out of jumping that he would speak only with Assistant District Attorney Thomas Sullivan. Sullivan had previously questioned Sasso about those bad checks he had written. Working in shifts, men from the Emergency Services Division kept talking to the would-be jumper, trying to keep him from taking that last and certainly fatal step. Meanwhile, word went out to Sullivan at the DA's office. Traffic on the bridge was stopped, and the DA was rushed to the scene. Once he arrived, he spoke with the distraught businessman for a few minutes and finally managed to talk him out of jumping. As the experience during the Great Depression has shown us, a sudden decline in economic status or a serious business reversal are relatively common causes of suicide. Now, to understand how something like that, something like a business going broke, can push a man almost to the breaking point, we've invited Mr. Sasso on tonight's program. And Paul, the basic question I want to ask you is, what was going through your mind when you stopped that car on the bridge and you told those fellas that you'd be back?
Well, I had no other alternative in my mind because I exhausted all my powers to collect the money that was due me from my clients. And everybody was not coming to me, they were going to my wife. Night and day that doorbell was ringing, the telephone was going.
You mean your creditors?
Right. The 4 o'clock in the morning they'd be ringing the doorbell. They knew that I was owed a large sum of money, and the people that owed it to me, we had done the work for, they just weren't paying. And I had been to see the district attorney that morning, like you had said, trying to figure out a way to collect the money that was due me so I can pay my employees. These men had stuck by me since August. They didn't bother me for a dime. They knew the situation. They were trying to collect the money for me, and to no avail. And it got to a point where my wife was, believe me, I would have went off that bridge just to protect my wife. Because if I was gone, they would leave her alone.
Do you think that that's true? Did you have any insurance? I mean, would she have gotten any money from your death?
The money from the insurance would have meant nothing to my wife except she would have peace. I mean, a woman can just take so much. When that phone rings at 4 in the morning, when the doorbells ring, and they threaten her, come to me, I'm the man. But they wait for me to leave my home, and then they go after my wife.
Well, I know that you had taken out certain loans from sharks, so to speak.
I had to, because these men, they wanted their pay. It was Christmas time. Where else can you turn to? Can you go into the bank and say, here, I have X company owes me $100,000. Lend me money against it. They tell you no. The SBA turned you down, too.
How much did you borrow from the loan shark?
All told, $8,000.
How much did he demand as repayment of that $8,000 loan?
They wanted $15,000 back inside of 4 weeks.
You mean in 1 month, they wanted $7,000 interest on an $8,000 loan? Is that why you didn't consider bankruptcy as an alternative, as a way out?
True. Bankruptcy would have bankrupted my corporation. The money that was due me from my clients would go into the bankruptcy. These people don't go by bankruptcy.
Loan shark.
Right. You can't blame them because they don't come to you. You go to them. They're the only people that will give you the money. They gave it to me on the strength that I had a client that owed me, as you know, a substantial amount of money. This was supposed to come through within 4 weeks. They lost their loan in the bank, and then the whole roof came right down.
Did the loan sharks ever threaten you with physical harm?
Me personally?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How?
Well, I mean, like they say, you come to us, we don't come to you. If you make a commitment on that date, have the money on that date. They knew, you see, ordinarily if you go to a loan shark, you got to have someone vouch for you. I didn't need anyone to vouch for me because I was owed this money by a large company. And they knew that I was going to collect my money on
Paul,
the papers that I
had. Be straight with me now. I'm asking you, did the loan sharks ever threaten you?
Oh, definitely.
How? Tell me about it.
You can go from one beating to the next beating until you come up with the money. They won't kill you, but they'll break your legs every day until you come up with the money.
Why didn't you go to the police then? Why didn't you go to the district attorney and tell him that? Instead of chasing an accounts receivable that may or may not ever be collected, why didn't you go to the cops and say, help me, these men are coming after me, these men are threatening me, they're threatening my wife?
Well, for one reason, I went to them, they didn't come to me.
But that's not an answer, Paul.
You can go after one, there's always another one that comes up. I mean, you just can't, if you lent me the money and I came to you, right? And I went to the police and said, well, this man lent me the money, he's the one. Fine, you lock him up. But there's 1,000 more behind him that you can't lock up.
So you didn't go to the police because
you
were afraid?
That's right, I won't go.
But suicide is the last refuge of cowards. How did you think suicide would save your wife? It wouldn't have saved your
wife.
Well,
there's a standing that if you borrow the money, then the debt ends right there.
With you?
Right. It doesn't go any further. With the creditors, it's a different story. They figure they can get to me through my wife, and they have. I mean,
well, I think that that's, you'll excuse me if I say so, perverted logic. But if we follow that line of logic, why didn't you jump off that bridge that day?
It's hard to say. I mean, when you stand up there, it's easy to go up on the bridge. But when you look down, then you decide, is it worth it? And I have one person who I would say actually from nowhere pulled me out of there, and that was my wife.
You mean you thought of your wife?
That's
and you
right.
Thought of leaving her?
Right. You could take all the money I have coming to me and it couldn't take the place of my wife.
Would you ever try anything that stupid again?
I doubt it. But then one that never knows if they get pushed into that situation.
Well, I am obviously not a psychologist or a psychiatrist.
Sure.
I wish you well, though, and I never want to find you on the lower level of the Verrazzano or any other bridge. Okay?
I doubt it very much if you'll find me there again.
Okay. Happy New Year.
Thank
Paul
you.
Paul Sasso.
Please.
When I first asked Paul to be on this program, I thought that he was basically a really together, normal guy who was just pressed to the breaking point by those extraordinary circumstances that surround his life. I think now and during the commercial break, I just told Paul again that he really is a man who needs help, not only psychiatric help, because that's, I think, fairly obvious, but he also needs police protection. There are laws that protect men or women against their own folly. And if he was telling us the truth about those loan sharks, then I have to disagree with him, because if they've been threatening to harm him or his family, then there has to be something the appropriate authorities can do. They have to be able to protect him. They have a duty to protect him. They have to crack down on those bloodsuckers. If they have no power to crack down on them, then society is defenseless against them. In any case, I hope that he gets himself together. As for Miss Fanne Foxe, the star of the Tidal Basin Follies, I wish her well. I think she's really a sincere lady. She made some errors in judgment, but she's basically a sincere lady, a good mother. I wish her well with a new and hopefully more legitimate career. Captain Kirk, Bill Shatner, can take care of himself. He's totally together. And, well, that's it. That's it for tonight. We'll be back in a couple of weeks. In the meantime, peace. Thank you very much for watching, and good night, America.
Yes, I'm afraid. roll in. I'll be gone 500 miles and the day is done.